Shelter insurance has covered a lot of miles and a lot of cars and drivers since 1946. We like knowing we have you covered, so you can just sit back and enjoy the ride. Shelter insurance. We're your shield. We're your shelter.
Ask Agent Mark Manning about Shelter's auto insurance discounts.
John Chadwell from the Newport Economic Development Commission. Always a pleasure to get to come down and visit with you, sir. And I just want to say this. We walk in the door and get ready to set up, and you just hand me a list of some of the things that have gone on here in the last several years, some of the pluses. Our tax dollars are at work. They are at work. John, talk about some of the things on this list, because it is simply incredible. Talk about some of this.
Well, you know, everybody gives lip service to, we didn't get into this situation overnight, you can't get out of it overnight, but we tend, being people, that want immediate results. But over the last 13 years, the citizens of Newport have invested in themselves. And I mean, that's really what it is each person in this town, by paying that sales tax, invests in this community. So what we're going to talk about is what you've done. I mean, it's what you folks have done for this town.
Yeah, good point.
And every time that you pay that sales tax, you are making a difference in this town. We're just the ones lucky enough to get to do it day to day.
Right.
You know, and that is a blessing, and we enjoy it. But our unemployment rate's the lowest it's been in 13 years at 6.7%.
6.7, the lowest it's been in 13 years. Yeah. That's incredible. I mean, it's good stuff. Keep going.
Yeah. Our sales tax collections in the city limits, which is the amount of money spent in Newport. So if you take our sales tax and you extrapolate out, you can figure out how much money is spent in the city limits of Newport. It's up 8% this year. It was up about 7% last year, so that's 15%. And it was up 8% the year before that. If you go all the way back to the 13 years ago when the tax was passed, $65 million more being spent in the city limits of Newport now.
Wow.
Than there was 13 years ago. All right, that's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money. And so you see that increase. You see the increase with businesses. There's 12 new businesses in the downtown area just in the last 3 years through Drives Rent Subsidy Program. You don't have to drive around town long to see the new places like Hibbett Sports and Tractor Supply and all of those places. But think back about 13 years ago. I mean, I know some of these things are older hat, but we didn't have a Walgreens here.
Right.
Sears wasn't back in town.
Right.
We didn't have a Tractor Supply. We didn't have a Walmart Supercenter. We didn't have a Dollar Tree. We didn't have a Goodwill. You know, we didn't have any of those things when you think back 13 years ago, and now they're all here.
Yeah.
You know, and so it's been a slow gradual, and we kind of take for granted. But when you go back and say, what's happened since we started making this investment? We've brought back tons of manufacturing jobs. Southwest Steel wasn't here at all. They didn't even exist here when the sales tax first passed 13 years ago. Now they're building and will be at 225 jobs. Shearer's Foods, which was Medallion, when the tax passed, they were at 139 employees. By the end of this year, they're going to be at 425.
Wow.
You know, and you just keep going. We've added just right under 300 manufacturing jobs have been announced just this year.
Right.
You know, and so the jobs, the seeds have been planted. I mean, take Southwest Steel Processing. The seed was planted with Southwest Steel Processing. The first incentive they got was to come and create 54 jobs.
Right, absolutely.
You know, so, you know, they could have been, that could have been it. They could have created 54 jobs, we'd have given them the incentive, but they then came back and we gave them another incentive. They got up to over 100, they came back and they said we can go to 225, you know, and so it's been a growth process. It's been a growth process with each of these industries that has come in to town. You look at our available buildings. I mean, you look at the buildings that we have in town that are empty. And there are far fewer buildings that are empty than there used to be because these buildings are beginning. And a lot of the buildings people say, oh, well, I know an empty building here. Or I know an empty building there. I'll go check into it. And it's not available.
Right,
Somebody's using it for storage.
Empty for a reason.
Yeah.
Because somebody's using it.
Yeah, somebody's using it for some. It doesn't look like it's got a business in it, but they're using it for storage, or they're using it for this, or they're using it for that. And so we've gone from just right at 120 empty commercial buildings in town 6 years ago to about 38 right now.
Right.
And we've got calls every day. We've gone from when I first started in the office, we were averaging 18 or 19 prospects a year. Now we're, this year we've had 42 prospects through the middle of October. And so, I mean, you know, you just start looking at the activity, and that activity has come to the notice of a lot of people. One of the most interesting things, 13 years ago, right after the tax passed, the community here, and this is before I moved here, the community here asked the state, said, we're looking for another community. We want to go look and see how they do things to get some ideas. They said, well, you need to go to Morrilton. And so they took a big group over to Morrilton to see what they did with their downtown, and that's where some of our downtown ideas, to see what they did with other stuff. Well, last week, Morrilton came here.
Is that right?
Because Morrilton contacted the state and said, we're looking to do some things in economic development. Where should we go visit? And they said, you need to go to Newport. And so it's interesting, over 13 years, that we went to get ideas from them. Now they're coming to get ideas from us. In fact, 14 times this year, somebody's either asked us to come speak to them, or they've come to visit us, or they've asked for information about how Newport. And I'm talking about Fort Smith.
Wow.
I'm talking about Searcy. I'm talking about just all of these towns that you would say, well, why would they want to know what we're doing? You know, well, what they want to know how we're doing it because they're starting to see some of this success. Smart Asset Investments has said that we are the fifth fastest growing county in Arkansas over the last 2 years for business growth at 3.1%. We're working on a grant with a group, and they hired the Center for Rural Entrepreneurship, CRE.
CRE
is a lot easier. CRE to do a study on us, and our manufacturing wage since 2001, our manufacturing wage has grown 27.6%. That's the money people earn by working in a manufacturing plant. That's 18% faster than the national average.
Wow.
During that same time. And then they also did a business study, and since we passed the tax to today, we have 98 new businesses in town, according to them. And these aren't numbers we're coming up
sure.
with. This is numbers, we didn't know what all their numbers would be, but this is numbers people from outside of our community are coming up with and saying, here's what y'all are doing and here's how you're succeeding. And so, I mean, it's nice that we've planted these seeds all along the way, and now they're just blossoming and blooming. And we have, it's kind of like success breeds success.
Sure it does.
You know, because we've got other people coming in and saying, oh, well, I see that O'Reilly's built a new building in town, so, you know, we're looking at
more growth.
Now.
That's yeah. growth yeah. when somebody builds a new building.
Oh,
that's
absolutely.
Growth. Absolutely it is.
Well, I mean, you just think $15 million last year in construction, or $15 million this year in new construction, about $14 million last year, and then we got at least $6.5 million on the books for next year that we know is going to be built. And so, I mean, you just look at that, that's a ton of commercial construction.
Yes, sure it is.
And people don't realize, they look at the two car dealerships and they say, well, that's nice and that's good. As they increase, they're going to have to hire more people. They're going to collect more sales tax coming into the city. But they also are going to pay more property tax, which is going to benefit our public schools.
Right.
So this is every new commercial building that's built is worth a whole lot more than what those people moved out of.
Right. Lots of people, lots of organizations, lots of groups benefit
yeah,
from that.
Benefit. And so we're going to see this community growth just continue as the results give more money to the school to do stuff with. Then there's more sales tax money for the city to do stuff with, more sales tax money for the county to do so, more sales tax money for the college to do stuff with. And you just start looking at it and you're like, you know, it just benefits everybody. And it benefits our local businesses. So.
I think a lot of times, honestly, John, that you know, we as people, you know, you look at something and you go, well, I wonder why that's not going as well as it's supposed to. Some of us, not me, but I mean, there's just some people just like to dwell on the negative. But generally speaking, the majority of folks right here in Newport, Arkansas, appreciate where we are.
They do. And a lot, and I mean, I walk down the street and I'd say, 90% of the people I talk to, they're like, oh man, this is great, or that's great, or we look, you know, and they find something they like. You just have a handful
sure.
who you know, they don't like this. And granted, just because some things are going great, a lot of things are going great, doesn't mean they're things that aren't.
Sure.
I mean, we are a community. We will have issues for the remainder of the existence of Newport.
That is correct. You know?
There'll be issues long after you and I have
That's left. Right. Long after this show's come and gone.
But the goal is, as we work to improve, look at those issues and work on them. And then when we conquer one, move to the next one. And, I mean, my job security and Julie's job security and Courtney and Lindley is that there's always going to be issues.
Right.
So, you know,
yeah, right.
We can look at some success and say, this is great. But I think it's important for twofold. One, I think it's important you celebrate the success. And that's why I think everybody out there needs to pat themselves on the back for what we've done, because it wouldn't be done without you. I mean, without you, none of this would happen. 76% of you voted to keep the tax in place for another 10 years. This wouldn't happen without y'all. Pat yourself on the back, celebrate the fact we've gotten somewhere, and then it gives us the energy to roll up our sleeves and get back
to work. John Chadwell, that is amazing stuff. I mean, just that's incredible stuff. And we appreciate all of the, you know, talk about the folks of, you know, we make it happen. All of us make it happen. Right. You guys are just kind of the director of the happenings. Y'all direct the happenings.
Yeah, that's right.
Thank you, my friend.
No problem.
John Chadwell, NEDC, downtown Newport, Arkansas. Farmer's Tire Mart, 1501 Malcolm Avenue in Newport. As Mr. Tommy Bain always says, where the rubber meets the road. And you can see it behind us right here. Been here for many, many years taking care of folks in Jackson and surrounding counties with the tire business and service business. We want to take a minute to remind everybody about, when we film, we really haven't had any cold weather yet, but you can guarantee yourself that it's coming. Checking your antifreeze is something that you need to do. Drop it by Farmer's Tire Mart. Let them do that for you. They'll check your antifreeze. If you need some, they'll tell you you need some. And if they, you don't need to flush the radiator, they'll tell you that. They won't do any of that up front without your permission. But that's one thing that you need to do in wintertime. Another thing that's so important is checking the tire pressure in your car tires. The tire pressure is something, number one, that can help increase your gas mileage if your tire pressure is correct. So while you have it in there and they're checking the antifreeze, also ask them to check that for you too, the tire pressure. Something else, when you get service on your automobile, you get your oil change, they do the good things, the important things. They check belts, hoses, fluid levels. They're going to check it all for you when you get oil changes at Farmer's Tire Mart. It's a great place to do business. They do brake work. They do other type of work. They do everything except the major repairs on automobiles, like they don't tear down and rebuild engines, but I mean, or transmissions. But if it's some general maintenance on an automobile, they can do it at Farmer's Tire Mart. And Bruce has been here for many, many years. He takes care of the Black family, and he takes care of lots of folks here in Jackson County, especially right here in Newport. Do a little business with these guys, and remember that if you need a tire of any kind, if it's rubber, and you think that they might not carry it, they might not carry it. But I bet you they can get it for you. With ATV tires, motorcycle tires, I don't know that they do bicycle tires, but I do know they do truck tires and car tires. And if you need a boat trailer tires, you can get them there, ATVs, you name it all. And they can get it at Farmer's Tire Mart. Tommy Bain and all his staff invite you by and wish you a happy Thanksgiving and a very, very, very special holiday for their family. Their family always gets together, and we want to say happy holidays to Mr. Tommy and Linda Bain and their family. Farmer's Tire Mart, 1501 Malcolm Avenue, where the rubber meets the road.
October morning in the Ozark Mountains, hills are blazing like that sun in the sky. I fell in love there, and the fire's still burning, a flame that never will die. Moonlight dancing on a delta levee to a band of frogs and whippers. I lost my heart there one July evening, and it's still there, I can tell. Oh, I may wander, but when I do, I will never be far from you. You're in my blood, and I know. Deep in me. magnolia blooming, mama smiling, mallard sailing on a December wind. God bless the memories I'd keep recalling, like an old familiar friend. And there's a river rambling through the fields and valleys, smooth and steady as she makes her way south. A lot like the people whose name she carries, she goes strong and she goes proud. Oh, I may wonder, but when I do, I will never be far from you. You're in my blood and I know you'll always be. Arkansas, you run deep in me. I may wonder, but when I do, I will never be far from you. You're in my blood and I know you'll always be. Arkansas,
Arkansas,
you run deep in me.
Continuing with Unity Health and Harris Medical Center, we always like to come over and get to visit with some of the folks who actually make it work, that are the ones that are making things work and diagnostic. And Lisa Whitehead joins us. And Lisa, you're a very familiar face around Harris Medical Clinic, Unity Health. Tell us a little bit about you. Tell us about where you grew up, what you're doing. Tell us a little bit about you.
Well, I am Lisa Whitehead. I've been here 26 years.
Wow.
Yes, a long time.
Wow.
Older than the bricks on the wall.
So that's correct. That is correct.
But I have been director of the department for the last 15.
And what department is that?
Radiology.
Radiology department, 15 years. Let's talk a little bit about the radiology department. And I think a lot of times, you know, you folks in medical will say some things and us common folks go, well, what is that? Radiology. In a general term, general sense, what is radiology and what do y'all do?
Well, we can just about do anything you need us to. We offer regular x-ray, we offer ultrasound, we offer CT, MRI, and also we also have telemedicine for level 2 high-risk pregnancy that comes in from UAMS. It comes in once a month.
Okay.
And they have their own tech that comes in and scans, but UAMS is there watching. And we offer that service too, so people doesn't have to drive to Little Rock. And I'm real excited to tell you about, we extended our MRI services.
Okay.
We're offering weekend services now, Saturdays and Sundays from 9 to 5.
Okay.
That will help people out that can't take off work and don't want to have to drive somewhere and have it done. Have your test done right here at home.
Yeah, absolutely. And we encourage folks all the time to do business here with our local hospital. And I want to hit back on one thing when you talk about UAMS and what they do. Explain that again. I'm not quite sure what were you talking about with UAMS. What do they do on the telemedicine
program? It's the high-risk pregnancy ladies that's pregnant. And okay. Instead of them having to drive to Little Rock for an appointment down there with the doctor, we don't. UAMS has their own tech that comes in once a week. And we just offer a room for the tech to scan.
Okay, good.
And so the patient doesn't have to drive and they can deliver their baby here, you know, and they still don't have to drive.
Wow, fantastic. Mm-hmm. I want to ask you something else here. You talk about how many years you've been here. I'm sure there's a lot of changes, and not to put you on the spot, we didn't even talk about what we're going to talk about here, but I'm sure there's been a lot of changes in diagnostic equipment and, mm-hmm. and the way you do diagnose things now. Talk a little bit about the changes since you've been here from the very beginning.
I've seen a lot of changes.
Yes, I bet you have.
Yes. We are currently fixing, well, as of December 1, we're getting a new CT scanner. We're getting a 64 slice scanner, a much faster scanner for our patients. That's a new piece of equipment we're getting. And my equipment I have now, my ultrasound, is the same as they use at Baptist or wherever you go. I mean, it's top of the line is what I have. We have that kind of equipment here. We can offer everything you need done here, you know, in radiology.
Yeah, you don't have to go anywhere else.
We have nuclear medicine services.
Wow, yeah.
We have it all.
Absolutely. Talk a little bit about, you know, being here and you see the changes and talk a little bit about the physician. The physician has to come in play for us to come see radiology, correct?
Yes, that's true. Your physician will order the procedure that you need done.
Okay.
Getting back to the MRI that we're offering on the weekends, your physician will give you an order for that, and you can call central scheduling and schedule that through them. And if you have any other questions, you can call me at 870-512-3004. That's the radiology's office number, and then we can take care of you there.
Hey, that's good stuff. You know, when you really, you talk about radiology, and most of us go, radiology. I know what that might be, but I think a lot of people don't know what that entails. I mean, it's X-rays, it's MRIs, it's CAT scans, it's that type of stuff. And you've been doing it how many years?
26.
Started when you were three, I assume.
Yeah,
started when you were 3 years. Lisa, we appreciate you taking time to visit with us. Interesting stuff. We're at Harris Hospital or Harris Medical Center, Unity Health Harris Medical Center, our hospital of choice right here in Newport. Customized vision care in the Newport Village Mall with the area comedy 5 to 10 minute program that we present to you exclusively here on Cable Channel 15 TV in Newport and Cable Channel 6 in Batesville and all over the website, the internet, and Facebook. It's the comedy show. Hi, sir.
Good. We're really big in Japan.
We have been big in Japan, no doubt.
And actually, when we go there compared to the stature, we are big in Japan.
That is correct. That is correct. Hey, you know, it's amazing, though, the people that talk about this show. I mean, it is amazing. And I don't know that any of them do any business with us or not, whether they come in and get their eyes checked.
I have several people, hey, I saw you on TV.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
How was it? Well, you're a little off this time.
You weren't on top of your game. Where do you get your glasses? Down the street?
Down the street.
But,
like the comedy show. It's all right.
What's going on, Dr. Gavin McDowell?
Not much.
Everything good in your world?
Well, as good as it can be, I guess. Like I was telling, I'm done coaching, you know, my kids' respective sports, so yeah.
We talked the first 15 minutes about Dr. McDowell's first experience in the volunteer coaching world, and sometimes it's an experience.
Oh, it was an experience, all right. I learned a lot from that experience.
I guess more importantly, and I didn't ask you, are you going to try it again maybe?
I probably will.
Good deal.
I probably
Good
will,
deal.
Yeah.
And because I appreciate what you said when you talk about it, I really don't have the time, and none of us have the time.
Exactly.
But
yeah.
You make time.
You got to make time,
absolutely.
Especially for stuff like that.
And absolutely.
That's why I mean, you know, I'm very big on trying to do things in the community.
Sure.
And you know, whether community I live in, community we work in, community we trade business in.
Absolutely.
So, absolutely.
And you have to do that.
Have to do that. And also, you know, it's a big thing for me to volunteer doing stuff like that, and as well as sponsor things like that.
Right.
I have patients come in all the time, and this is not a knock against other companies or whatever, but, you know, people come in want their contact lens prescription so they can get their stuff online or get their glasses online, which I'm comfortable with the contact lens online. I'm not comfortable with glasses online. I don't.
Okay.
Not many people go on the website and order a car and have it delivered and drive it without test driving, so to speak. But anyway, but that's a different show.
There you go.
But you know, I have patients who want to take their prescriptions and do things elsewhere, and that's their prerogative. That's what they want to do. But I will say this: when's the last time you saw a kid's little league team sponsored by 1-800-CONTACTS?
Yeah, they don't do any sponsors.
Yeah,
those.
Yeah, they're not a community thing, and I understand you're going to save money by doing a lot of those things, but the quality they have obviously is going to be less, but you get what you pay
for. The service is going to be so much less. Yeah.
But
the service is zilch.
It's one of those things where, you know, I want to be a part of the community, and I want people to understand that when you trade local, and it's not just me, it's all other things local. When you trade local, you're doing more than just supporting local business. You're supporting local people who are you know, living, you know, working in those businesses, and you're supporting your own community because you're giving your money in that area.
You know, the old adage of every dollar that is spent turns seven times in a community, so that's seven people that got to handle that dollar.
Exactly.
So, and when you get up and talk about tens and thousands and hundreds of thousands of dollars, it's a lot of money that circulated right here
Absolutely.
In a local community like Newport, Arkansas.
Which is, this is so much drier than our normal stuff.
Yeah, it is.
How do we, quick, tell a joke.
I don't know any. I don't know any. I don't want to tell a joke, but one thing I do want to mention that's probably the most important thing that we've ever talked about on this program is the retirement of Miss Joyce.
Yes, yes.
She's
Miss Joyce
retiring.
She is retiring, yes, ma'am. Yes,
I asked her why, and she just, I told her, I said, you know, I always thought retirement was associated with people that were older and not anybody, you know, her age or my age.
Right. Well, obviously, your age.
I know. And she said, well, that's right. She said, I'm going to go ahead and retire a young lady. And I said, well, I don't blame you. Miss Joyce Malden is retiring after a lot of years here.
Many years.
She's been good to this company.
She's been fantastic, not only this company, but to the people of the area. Everybody she's serving. There's people, especially when I first came on board here and bought the practice, there was people come in wanting to see Miss Joyce. They had no desire to see me. There was no reason they wanted to talk to me. They wanted to see Miss Joyce. And so that says a lot about her character and as far as how she put herself out there for everybody she worked with.
But, yeah. And we're having a big celebration.
We're going to have a
public invite.
November 20th. You know, swing by, say hi and bye if you want to Miss Joyce. I know a lot of people who frequent this office is going to be sad to see her go, but you know, we're going to keep her mentality. We gain from everybody who adds to this practice. We try to take whatever little nuance or add that they're given to us that works well and the patients like. We try to everybody mock and mimic. So
yeah,
she will be gone in presence, but not in spirit. That's for sure.
You know, you look at businesses, and traditionally you have a lot of turnover in business. Doesn't matter what business you're in.
Right.
You got people that get a better job, or they move, or they don't want to work anymore, whatever. When you can get somebody in that works for one company as long as Miss Joyce did.
It's over 20 years she's been.
Yeah, I mean,
that's
pretty solid. That means, number one, she's doing thing right for the customers, and that the people that she's working for are doing thing right
Absolutely.
For their customers,
right.
too.
Right, exactly,
Yeah, absolutely. And congratulations, Miss Joyce, 20-plus years, and love her to death.
She's going to be stir-crazy in a month and a half, but anyway, it's...
Well, yeah, well, we'll do our show in January or February, and we'll talk about it's the comeback party. Joyce is back.
She's back. We're having another party. She's paying for this one,
That's right. She's back. Well, what's going on in the field of medicine and eye care and anything of great value that we need to discuss on this
program?
Well,
there's always new things going on, but, I mean, to say that something new and special is in, not so much. No.
Your glasses, though.
Thank you.
I noticed those when I came in.
This is the official, I've gotten old. That's...
Well, mine are just like yours, so what does that mean?
We're both old.
I guess it does.
You're older, obviously.
I'm a lot older.
I've heard that you'd once gone to a school. Well, actually, Methuselah went to a school named after you, right?
Is that right?
That's what I hear. That's the word on the street.
I hadn't heard that.
It's probably because your hearing's going, too.
That's right. And went years ago, didn't it? It went years ago. We'd have fun at this clinic, at this place of business, and it's one of those places that when we go along the way and we film, we have a pleasure from... I mean, when we come in and sit down and we have to wait a few minutes because you're a busy guy, and we just kind of listen to how everybody talks.
It's
a fun place to be.
I know I've said this before, and I'll say it again. If you're looking for straight lace, me in a coat and tie, and all professional, I assure you, you will not get that here.
No, we don't serve that here.
Let's put it this way. I'm professional. I like to think I'm professional.
I think you're professional.
Well,
we did that several months ago. There is some professionalism that goes along with
absolutely. But here,
some.
But it's very much outweighed by personality. And that's what I really, if you come and visit us, try us out. I assure you, you won't be disappointed. It'll be different, that's for sure. But you're going to get the same level of service and the level of care that we provide is, I fully believe, top of the line. So
no doubt in my mind. No doubt in my eyesight either. Because boy, I'm
your eye vision.
My eye vision. I've got some eye vision care. I got eye vision care at Customized Vision Care
with
Dr. Gavin McDonald. Always. Always my pleasure, sir.
Oh, no, pleasure is definitely mine.
Let's continue on with more of the Business Spotlight. Karen Hunt, Jackson Funeral Home, joins us, and going to talk about a couple of things. One of the big things we like to talk about when we come to Jackson Funeral Home once a year, and it's in November, we like to talk about our veterans. And
yes.
We have some flags and some other memorabilia type stuff in the background. Talk a little bit about Jackson's Funeral Home and veterans.
Well, here at Jackson's Funeral Home, the majority of us come from a long line of military men.
Yes.
You know, someone had, you know, your grandparents were in World War II, or your parents, or, you know, all the way down. So we have a great deal of respect for our veterans, both World War II, you know, all the way up to now, even people who didn't serve during wartime. And so what we do is work with our families to be sure that our veterans get everything they're qualified to get. Every veteran is entitled to a flag.
Okay.
We provide the flag. It can be folded and placed at the head of the casket. It can be draped over a casket. If you have the DD-214, which is the military discharge, we go through the Veterans Administration to apply for and receive a VA marker.
Okay.
As long as you have an honorable discharge, you are entitled to that, and we think our veterans deserve it. Another thing that we can do, and that we've started doing a lot more often, I think people are a little more patriotic than they were for a while. It's more important to them. Is if we have a DD-214 and 48 hours notice, we can usually contact the military branch of service and have graveside military honors.
Wow.
At least a three-man team. They play taps, present, and fold the flag. It's really nice.
If you have ever been to a funeral where taps is played, I mean, it just sends a chill up your spine.
Yes, it does.
And I want to talk about one in particular. When Mr. John Mullins, our superintendent of schools right here, and I had the great honor that Patty asked me to be a pallbearer at that funeral. But when we put ourselves in a position to be a part of something special, you know, we're honored to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And we're standing out there at that cemetery that day, and it's at the conclusion, and from about, I'm gonna say 50 yards away, serviceman comes out from behind a tree. Mm-hmm. He'd been there for the 15 or 20 minutes and nobody had seen him, and played taps, and it's just, oh man.
It's hauntingly beautiful.
Yes.
That's just
yes.
The best way I can describe it. It's hauntingly beautiful.
It is that. So let me ask you this. If you are a veteran and you get the forms and everything, when you're sitting down with a family, is that something that most families will say, he is a veteran or she is a veteran? Or do you have to ask, were they a veteran? Yeah.
We always ask. Now,
because we might not think about it.
Right.
You know, if we're the family.
And you have some families that their loved one was, that's a very important part of their life.
Right.
Was their military history. And so that's one of the first things they tell you.
Right.
You know, daddy was a veteran. We want military honors. We want this and this and this. If they don't tell us, we always ask.
Right.
We never want a veteran to go unrecognized. And so we give you the opportunity to have all of the services. There's no extra charge for any military service. Of course, it's done by the government. All we do are work as the messengers to them to get the information. So there's no extra charge there. And it's just a really wonderful way to pay respect.
When you talk about veterans and you talk about our World War II veterans, you mentioned them, and we're losing veterans every day, World War II veterans, and eventually that comes to where there are no living World War II veterans. I mean, it happens in everything, but that's something that you don't think about a lot, and you really don't it's not something that comes out and says, well, we may not have any World War II veterans in the next 20 years.
That's right.
I think a lot of times we neglect those people after the fact. Not we as a funeral home, but we as an American society.
As a people.
As right. a people. I think we neglect a lot of veterans just by maybe not honoring them. Whether it's a Vietnam War or whatever the case may be, or, you know, war in Iraq or Afghanistan. And you know, these soldiers going in and come home and it just... hadn't been as much hoopla, I guess, anymore.
That's right. They are not receiving the hero's welcome.
And they should. Well, they receive a hero's welcome when they use Jackson's funeral home here.
Yes, they do.
Hey, I do want to mention this. I do want to mention before we get out of here, you guys are in the process of planning, talking about, scheming, trying
yes.
to figure out just exactly what you want to do on a Christmas program this year. But we're coming up with some ideas.
We are coming up with some ideas, and we will be announcing the time and the place and exactly what our plan is very soon. So there'll be some talk about that, and we'll have some information about out and about in the public before long.
Good deal.
Yeah.
I know it'll be good whatever you do.
I hope so.
Yeah. If you're in charge, girl, it's going to be good.
I appreciate the vote of confidence.
That's right.
I really do.
Karen Hunt, Jackson's Funeral Home, we always appreciate her taking time out of her busy schedule, and I mean it's a busy schedule, to come visit with us here on the Business Spotlight. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Bud Black on sports, and welcome to one of the man caves here at the house. We're here on behalf of the Bank of England. Kenny Thaxton out at the mall looking for a mortgage, looking to refinance your home, looking for a great rate, somebody that'll take care of you. We highly recommend that you go by and see them before you do anything. Let's talk some sports. Well, it has been a tough season for the Newport Greyhounds. It ended up being a tough football season. But, you know, the good thing about this is every now and then, you're going to have a clunker. Now, the Greyhounds have been very, very lucky that we haven't had many of those in the last 50 years. And as David Black says, is hold on, help is on the way. With all due respect to the kids that went out there and gave it their all this year, when you look down below at the junior high level and the seventh graders and the fifth and sixth grade, there's a lot of talent. Now, just because there's a lot of talent back in the fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh grade doesn't mean that you can project that down the road, because, you know, kids grow up, they change. Some kids don't live here anymore, they move away, but others move in. There are a lot of factors involved. Their grades may not be good enough to play. So young guys, you got to be smart, you got to make your grades, you got to do your best. You don't have to be the most intelligent person out there. But if you work and you work hard and get your grades, even if you're an average student, that'll qualify you to play and participate. And one of these days, who knows, among you there may be some kids that can play some college sports. But to do that, you have to maintain a certain average in the classroom. College coaches don't want to fool around with folks who don't make an effort, not only on the field, but also in the classroom. Because if you can't make it in the classroom, you can't make it on the field. I hear people complain about the University of Arkansas, where they just kicked off two guys. Well, they did because the kids wouldn't go to class. And look, you've got to go to class. That's why you go to college. Not to be there to play football. You're there playing football or basketball or baseball or being on the cheer squad because you were given some money to do that and you earned that. But they give you the money to come and go to school. I know it doesn't seem like that, but that's the way it is. But anyway, back to the Hounds. Big things are about to happen for the Greyhounds in the coming years. I salute the coaches and the kids who went through a terrible, terrible year this season. I salute them, regardless of, you know, what happened the rest of the way, for the big victory against Lone Oak that meant so much when all of us were devastated by the loss of Coach Bill Keady and the kids' dedication in that football game. It'll be something that we will always remember. So, Greyhound fans, hang in there. Things are going to get better before they get worse. It's going to improve. Let's just encourage all the young kids who have been participating at the lower levels to stay with it and have that dream of being a Newport Greyhound and wearing that orange hat up there with the big boys. And I promise you, over the next 2 to 5 years, great things are going to happen once again in Newport with the Newport Greyhound football team. As baseball wrapped up and we have a world champion, the Kansas City Royals, who finished 90 feet away from that title last year, we salute the Kansas City Royals. I think after having looked at everybody, by the time it was said and done, from top to bottom, pitching, hitting, defense, timely hitting, power, speed, intelligence, I think the Kansas City Royals were indeed the best team in baseball. They didn't have the best pitching. They didn't have the best hitting. They didn't have the best power. They didn't have the best speed. They didn't have the best defense. But let me tell you what, they were very good in all areas, and that made the difference. The Cardinals had a lot of shortcomings. Can you imagine a team won 100 games and we're complaining about the Cardinals? Because we looked at them and thought, you know, if they could do that and play the way they played winning 100 games, they ought to set an all-time record and win 120 or 125. We're never happy, and I understand. I'm a Cardinal fan, and I'm never happy, and I'm glad they won 100 games and won the division this year, but and then they lost to the Cubs. But, you know, that didn't hurt me very bad. It really didn't, because it's kind of got to where you expected it. The Cardinals were limping home down the stretch. 2 years in a row they limped in the stretch, but got there. That's the good news. But they just didn't look like the same baseball team in October that they were back in June and July. They got off to the great start. They maintained that lead except for one spot or two where Pittsburgh and the Cubs got a little closer. But it was a very good, very, very good year for St. Louis. There are major changes, I think, that have to take place for the Cardinals to remain competitive in the National League Central Division, because Pittsburgh will stay about like they are, maybe not quite as good. The Chicago Cubs will be better if for no other reason they have the same people coming back, and they are a year older, wiser, and stronger, and those kids are only going to get better at Chicago. And there are other teams like the Mets who have the great fearsome foursome starting pitching, and I think they will continue to be better. Their defense let them down in the World Series, but they had some timely hitting along the way also. But the Mets relied on pitching. The Dodgers have relied on pitching. The Cardinals have relied on pitching. The Cardinal pitching staff is kind of, it's been frayed at the edges a little bit. We have to see what they're going to do with John Lackey and Garcia. Those are two big question marks. Can Wainwright come back and be Adam Wainwright? What do they do about the kid Anthony Reyes down in the minors, who everybody says is the best pitching prospect in maybe all of baseball? Does he pitch next year for St. Louis? Very likely. They've got to make some moves. They've got to decide if Wong is their second baseman, if Carpenter is better off at first, second, or third base. What do you do with Peralta? Do you move him to third, Carpenter to first, Carpenter over backward to second? Then what do you do with Wong? What do you do if Matt Adams tries to come back? I mean, what do you put Piscotty at first base? Do you sign Hayward? If Hayward's there, you know, it changes everything. Then what do you do with Grichik? Does he play in the outfield? Holiday's 35, 36 years old. He's not the same player he used to be. 3 home runs last year. I mean, come on. Come on, that's not going to get it done. And so a lot of question marks. And the big thing is, and I've said this always right here, the Cardinals are not going to spend the money. They're not going to spend the money the Cubs spent. They're not going to spend the money Pittsburgh spends. They're not going to go out and get a free agent for $25 million a year. I hope I'm wrong. Y'all tell me next month when I do my next show, Bud, you were wrong. They went out and signed David Price for $25 million a year. They went and got Cespedes for $18 million a year. They're not going to do it. I don't think they're going to re-sign Hayward unless he just decides he's willing to take less money because he likes the situation in St. Louis. And that may be the case, but he'll get offered more money in several other places. I mean, it's all about money to him. He'll go. And if it's all about money to David Price, he'll go somewhere else like he's done already. Cardinals have said, we flirted with this. The Cardinals flirted with getting Tulowitzki. Oh, but he's hurt all the time. So he goes to Toronto. What do? They win their division after being in the middle of the pack. But I just don't think the Cardinals are interested in making a move. And they like this a little too much. I mean, you know, they like making that money. And after all, it's a privately owned business. And their objective is to first and foremost make money. Don't forget that. You know, people gripe about Jerry Jones and the Dallas Cowboys, you know. Fill them up with 120,000 people. And Jerry Jones wants them to win. But you know what? The bottom line is, if the stadium's full, if people are buying the beer, they're paying $12 for a box of popcorn, $80 to $250 for a chair for 2 hours, They don't care whether they win or not. Only you and I, the fans of the game, the fans of our team, are pulling for them really, really hard to win. To the other folks, the players included, it's business as usual. Hey, have a happy start to the holiday season, a great Thanksgiving before Christmas gets here. We'll talk to you again on behalf of everybody here at Cable 15 TV and on behalf of Kenny Thaxton at the Bank of England in the mall. Wish you a good day. I'm Bud Black. So long for now.
Terra Salinas Merchants and Planters Bank, downtown Newport, locations throughout Northeast, North Central Arkansas, and welcome to the show again.
Why, thank you so much.
We have had a blast before the show, just talking stuff.
We're funny.
Yeah, I think we are too. We need our own show.
We should get our own show. That's a brilliant idea.
I think we should do that. Merchants and Planters Bank, my hometown bank, your hometown bank, and if it's not your hometown bank, certainly needs to be. Tell us about what we've going on. It's holiday season. A lot of things happening.
You know, this is the time of year when things get busy. You all get busy. We get busy. You know, there's things to do, lots of places to be, lots of gifts to buy, and just lots of things to think about. And so when you're making your plans and preparing for the holidays, we hope you'll think of us. We're here to help make it a little easier. You know, we have several things set up to assist you in your holiday gift giving. You know, we always have our Merchants and Planners Bank credit card.
Sure.
It's the only local, you know, credit card around. We've got somebody in-house here that can assist you with getting it set up and getting your limits. If you ever have any issues, you're not calling an 800 number somewhere far away. You're calling Alexis Hall here in our offices, and she can help you with anything. Great rates, and you know, it's good to help with the holidays. You know, we don't encourage spending more than you should,
sure,
obviously, but it's nice to kind of give you a little cushion there and then, you know, take the next couple of months and pay it off.
Well, and you mentioned about the interest rate, and I mean, it's one of the few, you just compare the interest rate of that card to any other card in the country, and I mean, you can get a 0% card, and then, you know, 6 hours later, it's you know, 48%.
Right,
it's just a good, solid interest rate, and
it's a fixed rate. Our decisions on our credit cards are made locally here,
right, sure,
so,
absolutely.
You know, we try to make smart decisions and make sure, you know, we get you what works for you.
We had talked about, you know, this being the holiday and you've got a program that skip a payment. Talk a little bit about this program. This is interesting.
This is kind of a newer program. We did offer it last year, but this will be the second year for it, and things are a little bit different this year. We're allowing all of our consumer loan customers,
okay,
to, you know, with the holidays coming up and with things getting a little hairy, they can skip either their December or January consumer loan payment for a $35 fee.
Right.
Now, there are terms and conditions that apply. You need to speak with your loan officer. There's a form that we have that gives you all the specifics and kind of lays it all out for you. And, of course, your loan officer will explain it to you and make sure you understand how it all works. But for a $35 fee, you can skip your December or January loan payment.
I like that.
It's not a
I
bad
like
thing.
I like that.
You know, it's just to kind of help with the holidays. Like I said, it all kind of comes on at once. And so we just thought, hey, it's a good program, and it's a good way to help folks out. So if you're interested in that, you can call our location here at 523-3601, or you can speak to, you know, your local office, your loan officer.
Well, and we, you know, in the holiday, we're filming it the 1st of November. Of course, we've got Thanksgiving coming up. But in always right after Thanksgiving, in the, you know, the first week or so in December, we have something special that goes on at M&P. Tell us about our open house.
It is our favorite time of the year. We will start in the next couple of weeks probably decorating
for the holidays.
It's time. But we've already started planning our annual holiday open house. It's a big deal to us here because it's one of the few times of the year when we open the doors and just invite everyone in the community to come out. And we have the class from Under the Rainbow come and perform, and they always do a good job. And, you know, at that point, you may not have the Christmas spirit. You may kind of be bah humbugging it, but I just invite everyone to come and watch the kids because that'll get the Christmas spirit going.
Absolutely.
but it's going to be Friday, December the 4th, We'll start around 10, 10:30, and it'll go throughout the afternoon. We'll have good cookies and punch and lots of local entertainment. We've got a lot of really talented people in the community, sure. and we love for them to come out and showcase that talent. A lot of our own employees here are very talented, so we enjoy watching them perform. I think we're going to have a violinist class come and perform some Christmas music. So it's a good way to get in the spirit. It's very low stress. You know, just come by, have a cookie, and enjoy the entertainment and kind of catch the spirit.
I think one of the things that you and I might consider doing is sitting down and doing a doing 5 minutes during the open house like we did 5 minutes before we got on the air. We're very entertaining.
Absolutely. I think we should. We could probably even take it on the road.
I think so.
Be a market out there for that.
I think we're good.
But I invite everyone, the whole community, to come by, like I said, and just visit with us and enjoy the holidays.
Another way to give back, Merchants and Planters Bank, our hometown bank, and the open house December the 4th is a big day. We invite you by and know it's going to be a special day for everyone. She's Tara Salinas, Merchants and Planters Bank, downtown Newport, our hometown bank. It's always a pleasure to get to visit with my good friend, Mr. Ted Hall. How are you, sir?
I'm fine, sir. How you doing?
I'm great. White River Area Agency on Aging, which is always a mouthful for anybody to say.
I can actually say that now.
Yes, sir.
When I first started this, I couldn't even say it.
That is right.
You bet.
But we want to discuss today one of the things that's so important is when we start talking about open enrollment. And you hear those two words a lot, Mr.
Right.
Ted, and some of us go, what is that? Where does that fall under? Tell us a little bit about open enrollment, when it is.
Well, they call it open enrollment, Medicare Part D, if we want to get really technical about all this thing. But it actually has to do with a person's drug program and dealing with Medicare. So one of the biggest things that we're asked, and do I have to do this every year? No. If you're happy with everything, then you don't have to make any changes. But the big deal is if you have changes that you've made in your medicine, or if you have questions about costs and those kind of things, it is important that you come and visit with someone like that, what we do. And we actually have two dates, and one in Jackson County, November the 17th. That'll be 9 to 12. And by the way, that's in our new offices there at Newport. And then on the 18th, we'll be here in Independence County, and that'll be from 8 to 1, and that'll be at the White River Medical Center Conference Room B. So anyway, there's some places where people can go and get help, and there's other places, I believe you can see it at Walmart and some other things, but actually it has to do with changes in your pharmacy or in your drug program. And again, with cost and things like that, it's probably not a bad idea for people to go by and check this out. And if they have any other questions, because that's the biggest thing, David, that we talk about here, is that if someone has questions about anything deal with senior care, then we're the place to go.
Been
doing this for over 35 years.
Right. And doing it quite well.
Right. And so we just encourage, if they have questions about this open enrollment, then they can call us here at the office. It'll be 870-612-3000. So just give us that call, and whether it be about Part D open enrollment, or if they have a loved one that they think might need some help in their home. Of course, we have assisted living over here at Eagle Mountain Assisted Living, which we're quite proud of. And then also, David, we have about 188 apartment units throughout our 10-county area. If someone that is 60 or older has a need to stay, so we can take care of those. But a lot of people just need to know that if they have questions, we keep kind of running this to ground, you might say, but give us a call, and then we can get them connected with the right people. Dave, most people don't know, we have over 650 employees.
Right.
And we have a 10-county area. And some of our services we have in certain places and certain areas we don't. But anyway, it's good to keep everybody in tune about what we do.
As I get older and as we get older and our age of people are at that age that we're not necessarily got to have something right now, but we very well may need something in the future, mm-hmm. or there are a lot of us who are at this age that we do need some help. But I think one of the big things when I'm talking with people, they say, well, what exactly, because I was right beside y'all for a long time, so what exactly do they do next door?
Oh, you're right.
And I mean, there's just a litany of things when it's dealing with aging, sure. White River Area Agency on Aging, and the services that are provided by what you guys do. I think everybody in the country ought to have to walk through your door just to find out just exactly what you do.
Absolutely.
Whether you need it or not, you may, we've talked about this several times, you may live away, parents may live away, and you go visit your parents, and then something's not quite right, and you go, oh my goodness, we'll have to do something. What do I do? Who do I go see? Something right here, they come see you guys, because you guys got some answers.
Absolutely. And this is another point that I wanted to make, David, that I wanted to really, forgot to. I'm getting a little older, I forget sometimes.
That's right, we do that, don't we, Mr. Ted?
I was at a conference yesterday in Little Rock, and they were dealing with exactly the issues that we're talking about. But what we have found out in this new task force that's been going on, the number one thing that the folks from out of state, and they looked at all the things that we need to be looking at in-home services, the fact that people rather would stay home as long as they can, and there's nothing wrong with nursing homes or anything. We're not saying that at all. But there's a time that someone probably needs to go.
Sure.
But most people want to stay at home, and we can help do that. And that's what we do every day, is in people's homes, whether it's cooking or whether it's help giving baths or whatever the need, shopping or whatever, we have the ability to do that. And we have, we work with veterans, we do with private pay, we just have just a lot of ways to help people, but they got to call us and come see us. So that's
you'll have some answers.
Not a high pressure deal, it's just that we got a lot of things we'd like to share with them, and we'd be glad to do that.
Well, it's one of the few organizations, or one of the few businesses that you say that we're really not selling anything here.
Not really.
We're offering a service. We're offering a service that if you need our services, you need to find out what our services are and a little bit more about what you and I are talking about here today, because the service, I mean, you've got a litany of services that go from top to bottom that can help many, many folks.
You bet.
Good to see you, my friend.
Okay, good to see you,
Mr. Ted Hall, White River Area Agency on Aging. He's a good fella.
Hello everyone, and welcome to the November edition of the Farmers Supply Association Jackson County Agriculture Report. Well, we were really going well with our harvest until October 23rd, and our weather pattern has really changed since that point. You know, with rice harvest, corn harvest, grain sorghum harvest, all went really well. Soybean harvest started out real good, and a lot of our guys got through with soybean harvest. But for those that didn't get through, their crops were a little bit later, whatever the reason, things have really started to drag out. Again, it started raining on the 23rd of October, and we've had a lot of rainy days, cloudy days, such as we're filming today, and just hard to get soybeans harvested. So we've still got a lot of soybeans left in the field, or not a lot, but a decent amount of soybeans left out in the field. So, you know, harvest has really slowed down from it being so efficient back in September and much of October. But, you know, hopefully we'll get, you know, if we can get a good week of sunshine, in early November, sometime in November, we can get the rest of this crop knocked out and have it behind us. Next on the list, wheat planting. Wheat planting, we like to see it all planted in October. We got, you know, a decent amount of our wheat planted in October that we were going to plant, but again, that October 23rd beginning of the rainy period has really slowed down wheat planting. Again, we didn't have a lot of, weren't expecting a whole big wheat acreage this year, but certainly more that's planted so far as we tape in early November. So hopefully we'll get some weather to get the wheat that our farmers still want to plant planted. You know, we've got the month of November to get our wheat planted, but as we get into November, we consider that late planted wheat, and usually our yield potential is not as good with late planted wheat. You know, I've seen wheat planted around Thanksgiving before make good crops, but you really got to have the right kind of weather, kind of a milder, you know, fall, you might say, to get that wheat going. So, you know, we still got time to plant some wheat, but hopefully that'll happen pretty quick. When we get into these later time periods for planting wheat, there are two or three management items that farmers can consider that might help make that crop have a little bit more potential. One is increasing their seeding rates. You want to increase that seeding rate probably 10 to 20% over what you might have otherwise if you were planting in a more normal October time frame. So increase that seeding rate a little bit. The wheat that's planted later is not going to have as much time to tiller, so we want more plants out there to overcome the less tillers. As far as variety selection, that's very important for this late planting. We want to plant an early maturing variety late. So look at your maturity of your variety you're planting and try to select one that's early maturing, and this will kind of help compensate somewhat for that late planting. Also, you want to put a little bit of nitrogen in there when you're planting, or some pre-plant nitrogen out there. You could wait till after your weed is already up to make sure you've got a stand out there before you put this out. But we want about 30 to 40 units of nitrogen out there with this late planting, again, to overcome that lack of tillering. So we just want to increase that seeding rate. It'll help get what tillering you can out of that wheat. Again, you're not going to have as much tillering from the later planting, so that nitrogen will maybe help you get a little more than you might normally get if you did not have that nitrogen out there. Again, we want to consider ryegrass control anytime we're planting wheat. We want to get that ryegrass early, preferably keep it from coming up. So even with late planting, we want to keep that ryegrass control in mind. Some options there, pre-emerge applications after you plant the wheat. Anthem Flex is labeled to apply pre-emergence. Zidua is labeled to apply delayed pre-emergence after the wheat is germinated, so those are good considerations. Axiom is a very good early post-emerge herbicide for ryegrass control in wheat. The wheat needs to be spiking or coming through the ground before you apply this, so it's not a true pre-emerge control. So you want to get Axiom out there about the time the wheat starts spiking through. Wheat has pre-emerge, Axiom has pre-emerge activity, also a little bit of post-emerge activity. So if you've got some one-leaf ryegrass out there, it'll take care of it. But once that ryegrass gets past one leaf or so, you're not going to get much post-emerge control out of Axiom. So Axiom is another option right there. And once that ryegrass gets past the one-leaf stage, really up into the two-leaf stage and more, we're going to have to go to Axial as our post-emerge control. So Axial is a good option right there, and that will help control that ryegrass that has emerged. But again, you got to get it early. So hopefully we'll get some weather in November to get this wheat crop planted and managed properly as we go into winter. So hopefully that weather will occur. This has been Randy Klepechka with your Jackson County Agriculture Report presented by Farmers Supply Association.
Dillinger Funeral Home, Highway 367 north of Newport, and actually a new face, but kind of like a familiar face on our program. You look like that other guy that usually does the program. It's Tommy Allen, and you are?
I'm Anthony Allen,
you
but
are.
I look like my mama.
You do, don't you? She's a lot better looking than your daddy.
Yes.
My friend, good to see you, sir. We see you at every funeral. Let's talk a little bit about Anthony Allen and tell us about growing up and your folks and your family, and tell us about what you've got going on today.
Grew up in Newport and been married for 18 years, got three kids.
Yeah.
And been here since I was a kid.
You have, haven't you?
Started junior year of high school.
And, right. Just been here a long time, haven't you?
Yeah, just stayed around and played.
Anthony, when funeral homes have their own families outside of the family. I mean, when you go home to your family.
Yes.
And when you work here, this is your family.
That's it.
Talk a little bit about that. Talk about that feeling of getting to work with a family away from the family. And a lot of it is your family.
It is, but we have a good group of people. And everybody here is great. They work with each other.
Right.
And if somebody needs to do something, we always step in and take care. And just to help out so we can spend some extra time with the family or whatever we need to do.
You bet.
But we've all been here a long time, and we just work together to make everything happen.
Tommy tells you, Dad tells all the time on this program about the employees here, that nobody walked in the door and applied for the job.
No.
He or somebody went and got the people that he wanted. That's pretty neat to know that.
Yes.
Did you have any inside pull, because you were talking about you were a junior in high school? And
I washed cars, mowed yard.
You did, and that. I remember that. Yes, sir. Yes,
and
sir.
I decided this is what I was wanting to do.
Yeah.
And so I went to mortuary school and been here ever since.
Tell us a little bit about that. That's interesting. Tell us about that school.
Went to Dallas for 3 months. Did not like it. Big town, coming from Newport. So I left there and went to Mountain Home.
Okay.
And a whole lot smaller campus setting. And went, graduated in 1999, and went on and got my passed my national boards,
okay,
and just had my license ever since.
What, that school you're talking about, how long a school is that?
It's a two-year program two years apprenticeship. So
wow, so man, you got to spend some time.
You do
absolutely, and you need to, I mean, you got to have the education. You certainly got to know what you're doing in this business, and as in a lot of businesses. But we wanted to talk with our folks today about Tree of Remembrance, which is something we do here every year. Tell us a little bit about what it is in particular, what that thing is, and then when it's going to be.
Okay. Tree of Remembrance service is our service that's going to be December 6th, 2 o'clock this year. And what it is all the families that we served over this past year is just a way for them to come in and to spend time with other families and just help sharing process and a healing process. And there's also an ornament that we give and have their loved one's name on it, and it'll be on the tree. And after the service, we'll have refreshments and they can eat and get their ornament.
It's always a big crowd too.
Yes.
It's a big crowd.
Very big crowd.
Another way for Dillinger Funeral Home to give back to the community.
That's correct.
Hey, tell us the date once again and the time.
It's December 6th, 2 o'clock, and if you're out of town, had a loved one passed, or out of state, just call us and we'll get your ornament ready and you can come and attend too.
Good to see you, my friend.
Thank you.
Anthony Allen, he was the car washer, the lawnmower guy, the yard guy, and you've come a long way, but you got to start somewhere in this business. And you started at the bottom and you're up here. Near the top.
near the top.
By the way, Tommy wasn't feeling real well today. He's having a little health issue. He's going to be okay, but he said I needed a little fill-in. As a matter of fact, you may be the permanent fill-in. I think you may be a little bit better than he is on this.
A coin between me and Marty.
There you go. Anthony, I appreciate you so much. We're at the Dillinger Funeral Home. Always remember us, and remember the Tree of Remembrance is coming up, and it is a great deal to be a part of. St. Michael's Place, always a pleasure to get to come out and visit with some of the new staff. And this month we're featuring Amanda Plumley to the program, and welcome.
Thank you.
We always do a lot of great things at St. Michael's Place, and one of the most interesting things that we do when we get here is find out about the people who are employed here, what they do, where they came from, where they've been. Amanda, tell us a little bit about you. Tell us a little bit about growing up and being a youngster. Tell us all about you.
My dad was military. I grew up on the West Coast, graduated high school in Kansas, went to nursing school there, came to Pocahontas and finished nursing school, and got my RN, and came into, first of all, med-surg nursing, and then worked for the state as a nursing home surveyor.
Okay.
And then when I surveyed here, they asked me to come work here.
Really?
Yes.
Well, that's interesting. Interesting. Well, talk a little bit about your job here at St. Michael's. What's the job title and what does the job title entail?
Okay. I'm the MDS coordinator, and basically what that means is there's some regulated assessments that have to be done on all the residents for Medicare and Medicaid, since we've agreed to receive those monies.
Okay.
And I originate those assessments, do the majority of the assessment. With the rest of the staff, they have portions of it, and we send it in for basically billing.
Let me ask you this. You talked about being a surveyor.
Yes.
A surveyor. Tell me what that you were calling on nursing homes, correct?
Correct.
Tell us a little bit about that job and how that job transpired into this job.
Okay. There's a set of federal regulations. The nursing homes are actually the third most regulated entity in the United States after nuclear power plants and NASA.
Wow. Wow.
So that job, we take those federal regulations and we go into the nursing homes and make sure that they comply with all the regulations.
So are you sitting across the desk opposite of that now?
Yes.
Is that what you're doing? And
yes.
Then when somebody who like took your job comes in to see you, then you've worked it on this end and now you're working it on the other end.
Correct.
Tell me a little bit about the fun about working here. I mean, and I know it's a lot of fun. We do a lot of interviews out here, and I've never interviewed anybody that says, you know, it's a job and it's not a job. Tell us about that.
It's a family. We have one of the greatest teams here. Ever. We've got Catherine, who's a wonderful administrator. Mindy works social services with the residents. And we've got just a fabulous team.
Tell us about Pocahontas, Arkansas, and what you like about Pocahontas.
I like the fact that my parents are there.
Yeah.
That's my favorite thing. My children get to be raised close to my parents.
Yeah, absolutely. We appreciate you taking time to come visit with us and talk about the great things that are going on at St. Michael's Place. I know you guys do a wonderful job out here. What's the most important part of the job that you do? What's the most important part that you do?
The most important, I try to make the residents' lives better. That's, wow. I mean, on a day-to-day basis, I may be doing the paperwork, but they're my family. They're what keep us going here.
That's great. Amanda Plumley at St. Michael's Place, and she's got a very difficult job here in the paperwork itself when it's the third most regulated thing in the United States of America.
Yes,
and
sir.
And just as a kind of a kicker from the side note, when we were here to film just a couple weeks ago, we couldn't get it done because there were some folks here that was a little bit more important than what I was bringing to the table at the day.
We and had state surveyors.
Thank you so much for visiting with us.
Thank you.
St. Michael's Place in Newport.